Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Our today's session is again on Great Expectations, and we would continue with part 3 of Great Expectations. Before I move forward, I would like to share a quick review of the previous session. As far as the previous session is concerned, we started part 3 in that session. We covered chapters 1 to 10 of part 3. We followed the same scheme of analysis, that is, we explored the text of these chapters, we explored related themes, discussed the development of characters, and we also critically analyzed the selected parts of the text. Coming towards today's session, I would say that we would continue part 3 in today's session. We will cover chapters 11 onwards till the end of the novel. We will follow again the same scheme of analysis as we have already been following throughout the novel. That is, we will explore the text of these chapters and critically analyze the selected parts of text. We will also explore related themes and would see how text supports those themes. We will discuss the development of characters and their relationships as well. So, starting with chapter 11 of part 3. If you look at the top of the slide, you would see chapter 11, then after a colon, I have given 50. This 50 indicates the total, in total, the number of chapter, irrespective of parts. So, if you have a version that you are using for your text reading that does not give this division of chapters as such, you can follow this scheme as well. Anyhow, let's see what happens in this chapter. Pip himself was badly burned while he was trying to save Miss Havisham. If you remember that he had a meeting in the previous chapter with Miss Havisham, and Miss Havisham was a changed person. She not only felt sympathy for Pip, but also she wanted to help him in some ways. And she was ready to provide some money for Pip's friend as well, because initially Pip used to do all that. Now that Pip is burned, Herbert takes care of his burns when he goes home. Herbert has been spending some time with Magwitch, the person who is actually a source of a lot of intrigue and interest in the novel at this point again. Anyhow, Magwitch is at Clara's place, where he comes to know, that is, Herbert comes to know about the story of Magwitch. The story matches that of Jagger's housekeeper, Molly. Thus, we come to know that Magwitch is Molly's former husband and Estella's father. The woman had come to Magwitch on the day she murdered the other woman and told him she was going to kill their child and that Magwitch would never be able to see the child again. And actually, Magwitch never knew anything about the child for the rest of his life. Pip puts the pieces of this puzzle together to reach a conclusion and tells Herbert that Magwitch is Estella's father. Again, what we notice is that all the strands are being brought together and discoveries are made to sort out things. As far as the discussion points with reference to this chapter are concerned, I would say that yet other identities are revealed in this chapter. With the revelation of the identity of Estella, we can see a lot of things in a different light. There are many ironies and implications of this revelation. Estella is the daughter of a convict and a murderous tigress. On the other hand, Pip has always conceived Estella as wealthy, beautiful, and uncommon. Again, the theme of criminality runs through the text. Estella is more closely related to the world of criminals and convicts than even Pip himself does. Also, ironically, Pip feels he has not become what Magwitch had hoped for him. Magwitch wants him to be a gentlemanly son that he could not be. On the other hand, the very own daughter of Magwitch becomes ladylike. With this, we move to chapter 12 of part 3. In this chapter, Pip wants to make sure that he learns the whole truth. He tells Jaggers that he knows his servant woman is the mother of Estella and that Jaggers brought her to Miss Havisham. He also tells him Magwitch is the father. Jaggers was not aware of this and is surprised to know all this. Pip requests for more details in this regard. He also requests Wemmick standing by to help him. While doing so, he tells Jaggers of Wemmick's warm castle and of his aged relative. Now Jagger is amazed at all this and tells Pip more of the story. Once again, what we notice is that the strands are being brought together, the mysteries are being solved, the relationships are being made clear, and the story is being brought towards the ending now. Anyhow, Jaggers had in fact talked, or rather threatened, his servant woman out of keeping the child, and knew that Miss Havisham was looking to adopt. Now, since he knew that Miss Havisham wanted to adopt, he took advantage of the situation and he gave Estella to Miss Havisham. He said he wanted to save the life of the child, to give it a chance in life, because he had seen too many children in her situation grow up in and out of jails, affected by the surroundings of criminal environment. When we come to the discussion points with reference to this chapter, overall the chapter is more focused on the revelation of identities and relationships. Especially the identity of Estella is disclosed, and the parents, the relationship of the father and mother with each other, and the relationship of the parents with Estella is also discovered. All these discoveries are very, very much important with reference to Pip's expectations. Pip has always loved Estella. More than loving, he has always been inspired by Estella and her high position. Now, ironically, the same Estella belongs to a far, far lower status as compared to Pip. This brings us to chapter 13 of part 3. A message from Wemmick arrives. The message indicates that maybe now it is a good time to escape with Magwitch and get him out of England. Herbert and Pip plan to take the boat out with Magwitch in a few days, take him down to the Thames until they run into a steamer headed for a foreign boat. So this is the whole plan of the escape of Magwitch, as Pip and his friends have arranged for it. In the meantime, Pip gets another letter. This one is by an anonymous author telling him to come down to the lime kiln in the marshes that night in secret. Now that we are expecting that all the intrigues, all the mysteries are going to be solved, yet another intrigue, yet another mystery emerges, and that is through a letter that Pip receives. And since it is not clear who has written the letter, and Pip is asked to come to the marshes again near the kiln, the lime kiln, where he is supposed to meet that person. Once again, Pip goes to his hometown, as he has to go to the marshes to meet that person, and he walks out to the marshes. As Pip travels to the inn near his childhood home, he is reminded of his past relations, and how badly he neglected Joe since he became a gentleman. If you remember, the process of learning of Pip is taking place through part 3, and now at this stage, when half of part 3 is already covered, we can see that the process is becoming faster. So he realizes his mistakes, he realizes how he did not take care of the sincere relationships. Of all he loses, now Pip thinks that he regrets the loss of Joe's friendship the most. Thus, a changed and a more humbled Pip, with the realization of his folly, starts out to have the mysterious meeting on the marshes. By the way, this is a typo, this is D. Moving on to some discussion points with reference to this chapter, I would say that we notice once again that the process of learning of Pip is getting faster, as I have already said. He realizes the importance of Joe in his life. He realizes all the mistakes that he has made in his life. He is actually on his journey from a snob to a humbled man, as we would see him learning through all this process. This brings us to chapter 14 of part 3. This chapter mainly deals with Pip's meeting with that anonymous writer of the letter. It is a dark night that envelops the marshes. Everything is wrapped in mist. Again, what we need to understand is the use of the symbol of mist. repeatedly and throughout the novel, actually Dickens has used mist as a symbol. I have already discussed it at several points. If you can recall from the very beginning of the novel, the first meeting of Pip as it took place in the graveyard with the convict, who actually turned out to be Magwitch later on, the backdrop was of the mist. Again, when Pip, after the completion of the first phase of life, he, for achieving his great expectations, he was moving towards London. He was starting his journey to London. In the second part of the novel, again, mist was used as a symbol, and he couldn't see things clearly, and he didn't know what was going to happen. Now, again, the symbol of mist is used. Mist has wrapped everything that creates the environment of mystery around. Pip goes to the marshes to a shack near the lime kiln where he is to meet the anonymous writer. He enters an abandoned stone quarry and suddenly finds his candle extinguished because of the wind. There suddenly somebody attacks him. It is Orlick, who catches and ties him up. Pip does not want to die, not because he values his own life, but because he still has moral obligations to fulfill. And what kind of moral obligations? Obligations to fulfill with Magwitch, that is getting him out of the country, and secondly, obligations with relation to Joe, that is asking Joe for forgiveness. Orlick accuses Pip of coming between him and a young woman he fancied, among other things, and declares his intention to take his revenge. Orlick also admits to hitting Mrs. Joe over the head. So the mystery regarding the death of Mrs. Joe and her injury is also solved. However, Orlick says that it was Pip's fault because Pip was the favored one and Orlick was jealous of him. Orlick says he's working for Compeyson, and he further claims that Compeyson will make sure that Magwitch does not leave the country. Just as it appears Orlick is going to kill him, suddenly Herbert, Startop and Trapp's boy appear from nowhere, upon which Orlick escapes. It turns out that Pip had dropped the anonymous letter at home and Herbert found it. Of course, Herbert was concerned about Pip, so he and Startop came to the town and got Trapp's boy to show or to indicate them where the shack was. Anyhow, after this rescue, Pip rests a day at home. The next day, they plan to escape with Magwitch. There are two important discussion points with reference to this chapter. Number one, Orlick symbolically stands for random forces of violence. We do not see the role of Orlick much in relation to the development of the story, the development of the plot, or in relation to what happens to other characters. He as such does not have any strong motives to be against Pip or to have the desire to kill him. However, he just stands for those random forces of violence that for no reason would always be against the good. So Orlick stands symbolically for that. Second important point is that he is probably the only true evil character in the novel, who never learns and remains the same evil till the end of the novel. Through the novel, as we are now reaching towards the end of the novel, this is the last part of part 3, so we see that all those who did not learn, they are learning. All those who were evil, they are appreciating the good, and they are turning into good. However, Orlick is the only character who does not learn through all this process, and he remains the same. This leads us to chapter 15 of part 3. Mainly, this deals with the event of the effort to help Magwitch escape. The day of escape is ironically a bright sunny morning. A sparkling sunshine dazzles the whole London as Pip and Herbert prepare to put their plan into action. They start rowing down the river, picking up Magwitch at the already fixed time. All the day they rowed stream down, stopping at an inn when night fell. At the filthy, dirty inn where they stop that night, a servant tells them that he saw a suspicious boat around. Now again we see some complications are emerging with reference to the escape of Magwitch. and we as readers have now apprehensions whether Magwitch would be able to escape or not. Anyhow, Pip gets worried that it could be either the police or Compeyson. Also that night, Pip sees two men looking into his boat, which makes him even more worried and which makes him even more concerned about Magwitch. So they arrange for Pip and Magwitch to sneak out early the next morning so that this threat could be taken care of. Next day, their journey begins again. It takes place in the early morning. They are just within a few feet of a steamer that they hope to board when another boat pulls alongside to stop them. Jisko kehte hai na, do char haath labbe vaam reh gaya. This was exactly the situation. Just at a few feet was the steamer, and Magwitch had just to shift into that to go to some other land, and thus he could be successful in his escape. But suddenly, a boat pulls alongside to stop them. In the confusion, Pip sees Compeyson leading the other boat, but the steamer is on top of them. The steamer crushes Pip's boat. Compeyson and Magwitch disappear under the water, and Pip, Startop and Herbert find themselves in a police boat. Magwitch finally comes up from the water. They grapple and each slips under the surface, but only Magwitch appears on the surface. He claims not to have drowned Compeyson, though he says he would have liked to. However, he is suspected of drowning Compeyson and is shackled and arrested. Pip sits down next to the injured and exhausted Magwitch and feels that he will stay by Magwitch's side until the end. Pip also realizes that the English government will take all of Magwitch's fortune. Now, this last point is very, very important. Number one, Pip's decision to stay with Magwitch, irrespective of whatsoever happens. And number two, when he knows that Magwitch's fortune would be taken away, which implies that Pip would have no more money from Magwitch, and whatsoever he has from Magwitch would be taken away. Even then, he decides to stay with Magwitch. When we come to the discussion points of this chapter, I would say the chapter is full of intrigue and action. We see Magwitch's final fate in this chapter. We also see Pip relating himself to Magwitch, as I said earlier. We see him caring for him, that is for Magwitch, not ashamed of being associated with him and genuinely concerned about him. Also, we notice Magwitch seemingly unworried about the future. He is contented to be free for the moment and sitting next to the boy he considers as a son, and he does not worry at all what would come next. The very fact that the loss of Magwitch's fortune does not bother Pip demonstrates the extent and power of his transformation. He really is transforming into a real good person. He really is learning. This is what we notice about Pip. This brings us to chapter 16 of part 3. In this chapter, we see that Magwitch, who was caught in the previous chapter, he is brought to jail. Now Magwitch is in jail and is quite ill. Jaggers is certain that Magwitch will be found guilty and he would be sentenced. We notice that it does not affect Pip's loyalty to Magwitch. He is not even bothered by the fact that the government will appropriate Magwitch's fortune, including Pip's money. Herbert is leaving for Egypt with the firm in the position that Pip and now Miss Havisham had secretly set up for him. Herbert plans to marry Clara soon, and he offers Pip a job as his clerk in the company. Pip delays his answer, however, and the reason of this delay on part of Pip is that he wants to know about the fate of Magwitch, and he doesn't want to leave Magwitch alone in that miserable condition. Wemmick invites Pip to his castle on a Monday. We come to know that this is the first holiday Wemmick has ever taken in through his whole career of 12 years. He and Pip go for a walk till they reach a church, where to Pip's surprise, Miss Skiffins, who is waiting there, and Wemmick proceed to get married. So again, two more people in the story, they are settled and they find their happiness finally. As far as the discussion points with reference to this chapter are concerned, again I would say strands are being brought together. Neat ending to the lives of different characters is given. Two of Pip's best friends have found happiness. Herbert is settled in his new job. Wemmick has found Miss Skiffins to complete his life. Currently, Pip is in the worst situation, however. With no job, no hopes of future, he is left in a very, very critical situation. On top of it, Estella has married someone else and his adoptive father, that is Magwitch, is dying in prison. So there is no ray of hope for him as such, and he is just caught up in all these problems. Pip's great expectations have evaporated. He has failed to achieve any of them. And now does not have even the smallest expectation of a good, honest living with a good, loving wife that any common man could think of. However, Pip has learned, and it is a transformed person now that we see in the form of Pip. So, what he has achieved through all this process is that he has learned to be a good human being. This leads us to chapter 17 of part 3. Pip visits Magwitch daily in prison. Magwitch is ill, and the kind of resignation that he showed, that is Magwitch showed, was that of a man who was tired out. Now he wanted finally to rest. As Jaggers had already predicted, Magwitch was found guilty and sentenced to death. The sentencing was carried out with 32 other convicts also condemned to die. However, within 10 days of the sentencing, Magwitch dies in prison. Before he dies, to ease his final moments and to give him a happy moment, Pip whispers to him that the daughter he thought was dead is quite alive. She's a lady and very beautiful. This is what Pip tells him. Pip also asserts, this is not a set, by the way, this is asserts, R is a typo, and I love her. This is what Pip claims. Magwitch kisses Pip's hand in response and dies in peace. Pip prays over his body, pleading with God to forgive his lost benefactor, and thus the story of Magwitch comes to an end. Here are a few important discussion points with reference to this chapter. This chapter serves to present the ending of Magwitch's life. It also shows clearly Pip's transformation. We notice that during the trial of Magwitch and then his sentencing, Pip stands by him. At the sentencing, Pip assists Magwitch out of the chambers while onlookers point their fingers at them. But we notice that Pip is no longer a snobbish man who bothers about all this and who bothers about his image. He faces the reality and his association with Magwitch with grace. He honestly loves Magwitch and therefore does not fear showing this love in public. This reminds us, of course, of a different Pip who would not visit Joe and Biddy for fear that his gentlemanly image in the eyes of people would be affected. Dear students, with this we come to chapter 18 of part 3. Pip has suffered a lot of physical and emotional stress during the past few weeks. We have noticed him making struggle to plan for the escape of Magwitch. We also notice him going through all the emotional stress that he has to face as Magwitch is caught. Now the weakness caused by burns that he got while saving Miss Havisham and the fight with Orlick, combined with the stress caused by Magwitch's arrest and his death, makes him fall into a fever for nearly a month. He is also arrested for debt and faces the danger of being sent to prison. It is only because of his extreme ill health that he is spared of this punishment. He experiences wild hallucinations. Creditors and Joe fall in and out of his dreams. So his subconscious and his unconscious, they bring back to him the same images about which he is worried. Finally, anyhow, he regains his senses. As he comes back to senses, he realizes that Joe has been there the whole time, nursing him and taking his care. Joe tells him that Miss Havisham has also died during his illness. So the chapter of the life of another character, that is Miss Havisham, is closed here. He further informs that she left Estella nearly all of her property and also gave Matthew Pocket a great deal. The rest of the relatives were given very little. So the property of Miss Havisham that had been a huge issue in the initial chapters in part 1, that is also resolved now. Orlick has been put in jail because he broke into Pumblechook's house. So Orlick also meets his final fate there. As Pip slowly regains his strength, Joe, without saying anything, leaves one morning, leaving only a note behind. Pip comes to know that Joe has paid off all his debtors as well. Pip now wants to go to the forest to ask for forgiveness from Joe for everything he has done. He also wants to ask Biddy to marry him. Here are some important discussion points with relation to this chapter. Once again, Joe proves to be a very good human being. His love for Pip is always there, and we have always noticed it. So once again, he proves it. It is he who nurses him, it is he who pays off his bills, and it is he who forgives him before even Pip asks for it. Like Pip's childhood, Joe supports him when he is weak. Even now, Joe is most comfortable when Pip is at his weakest. As Pip grows stronger and healthier, Joe begins to distance finally again, and finally he leaves. This chapter also provides a neat ending to the life of Miss Havisham, as I have said earlier. With this, we come to chapter 19 of part 3. Pip returns to his hometown and is treated with a certain coldness by the town that was so kind to him when he was on his way to Great Expectations. So now what we notice is Pip's final journey back. There was a time at the beginning of part 2 when he was leaving for London, he was leaving this place. This is now the time when he wants to come back. Pip walks towards the forge. All he wishes now is to live a simple, happy life at the forge with Biddy. When he reaches there, he discovers that it is the wedding day of Joe and Biddy. He is, of course, surprised to know this, but he wishes them with all his sincerity and he asks them for their forgiveness for all that he has done to them. Now Pip goes to work for Herbert's firm. He starts living with now married Clara and Herbert. Life goes on. Within a year, he becomes a partner. He pays off his debts that are left and works hard. There are two main points related to this chapter when it comes to the critical analysis of the chapter. The first point is Pip's return to his original. As I have said earlier, Pip is on his way back to the place he really belonged to, he originally belongs to. The circle is being completed. After completing the cycle, he is being back to the original point. And this also indicates his completion of the process of learning. However, the second important point is with relation to the marriage of Biddy with Joe. This is also a lesson for Pip. What we notice that Pip assumed that Biddy would be waiting for him, and as he would come there, he would marry Biddy and he would have a happy life at the forge. He did not think of that Biddy could have other options as well. So Biddy's marriage to Joe is a lesson again for Pip, who again had false expectations without considering the desire or the consent or the options of other characters. Dear students, this brings us to chapter 20 of part 3, that is the last chapter of the novel. As we move to the last chapter of the novel, we notice a time lapse of 11 years. Being out of the country, working for Herbert's firm, Pip has not seen Biddy or Joe in 11 years. Now, after 11 years, he visits them finally and meets their son. Pip can immediately identify himself with this little Pip sitting by the fire with Joe, just like Pip himself did years ago. Pip tells Biddy that he is quite the settled old bachelor now, living with Clara and Herbert, and he thinks he will never marry. Pip also visits Satter's house that night. There he meets Estella. Her husband Drummel treated her very roughly and has recently died. She tells Pip that she has learned the feeling of heartbreak the hard way and now seeks his forgiveness for what she did to him. They discuss the past fondly. As the mists rise, they walk out of the garden hand in hand, and Pip saw no shadow of another parting from her. This is the point where the novel comes to an end. The final chapter of the novel actually remains a controversy with critics even today. What makes it a controversy? I would take you back to the previous slide to indicate a few things. It is important for us to see that Pip now is stable in his life. 11 years time has lapsed. He is quite set in his professional life, and now that he comes back, we also see the presence of Pip Jr., that is the son of Biddy and Joe. We notice that though Pip makes claims that he would not marry again and he would like to remain, he would like to remain a bachelor. We notice that Pip visits Satis' house and there he meets Estella. The ending of the novel actually varies. Dickens has given two versions of this. One is that he gave as the original version and the other one is that he changed later on. So this gives rise to certain controversies, which one is a better ending. We will discuss in a while it in detail. Actually, the ending of Great Expectations is more controversial than it may seem at first. Before writing the scene in which Pip finds Estella in the garden and sees no shadow of another parting from her, Dickens wrote another less romantic ending to the book. In this version, Pip hears that after Drummle's death, Estella married a country doctor in Shropshire. Walking through London one day with Joe and Biddy's son, Pip runs into Estella and they have a very brief meeting and shake hands. Though they do not discuss the past, Pip says he could see that suffering had been stronger than Miss Havisham's teaching and had given her a heart to understand what my heart used to be. However, Pip leaves her there and then the story ends. Dickens changed this ending at the suggestion of a friend, the novelist Edward Bulwer Lytton. He seems to be motivated at least in part by the desire to please his reading public with a happy ending as well. Though much more depressing, many critics consider the first ending more true to the story themes. Their argument in support of this is that throughout the book, it was Pip who had to realize happiness through his own internal process and not through some external situation such as position or wealth or any relation or a person like Estella. However, there is some justice in Estella and Pip finally finding love in each other as well, because what we notice is not only Pip has learned a lot through life, but also Estella has learned a lot of lessons. Because of their difficulties, they seem both to have come to a realization of what it means to be happy and therefore are ready for a healthy relationship with each other. Chapter 19 demonstrated that Pip had been living an upright life for 11 years when he finally runs into Estella once again. Estella might be seen as the final reward for a true Victorian gentleman. Which ending to be favored is reader's choice anyhow. So whether you like the first ending that was given when he published it in form of episodes in a magazine, and the second ending, as I have right now shared, that is a part of the volume when he published it all together. So you can make your choices in that regard. But the most important thing is that Pip has learned lessons of his life and he is going to use those lessons to make his future life better. Now that we have finished with the text of Great Expectations, we have been through the whole novel and we have looked at a lot of things happening, how themes are connected, how relationships are being developed, how characters grow, etc. At this ending point, I think it would be a good idea to visit the title once again. So Great Expectations, revisiting the title, I would say, now the title becomes ironic for us. The title comes actually from a speech in which a lawyer, that is Mr. Jaggers, explains to young Pip, Pip who is the protagonist, that he is to be taken from his poor home where he has had expectations of following in the footsteps of his brother-in-law and to become a blacksmith, and instead educated to become a gentleman. If you go back and look at chapter 18, Jagger announces there, "I'm instructed to communicate to him," said Mr. Jaggers, throwing his finger at my sideways, "that he will come into a handsome property. Further, that it is the desire of the present possessor of that property that he be immediately removed from his present sphere of life and from this place, and be brought up as a gentleman, in a word, as a young fellow of great expectations. So the phrase is taken from this sentence, Great Expectations, and it is made the title. Well, when it comes to the interpretation of the title, we can give various interpretations to the title. It has some symbolic nature as well, and of course it is ironic in a sense as well. Great Expectations shows, number one, on level one, Pip's expectations to be a gentleman. Number two, expectations of his benefactor, that is Magwitch, to make him a gentleman. And we notice that through this whole process of achieving those great expectations, ironically, it is proved that these expectations are false. The very first blow to these expectations is when, at the outset of chapter 2, Pip enters London. If you remember, he found London filthy, dirty place. He found London some place that is very, very unpleasant for him, where he does not feel comfortable. The images of ugliness are shown by Dickens to prove that point. So at the outset, his expectations are challenged. He who had left his forge, he who had left his marshes to go to the big city, to go to London, with the expectations that it would be a far nicer and a far better place, these expectations are defeated at the outset. Later on, as he lives in London, the life in London itself proves to challenge all the great expectations that he had. Life in London was not that smooth, it was not that easy. Pip had to struggle, Pip had to find his ways of getting settled. It also challenged the great expectations of Pip in the sense that he had come there to become a gentleman, he had come there to become a great man. However, there were no possibilities of that, and much of the time Pip spent just doing leisurely activities, fun-oriented activities, and as such not being involved in any kind of serious work. Then we saw that these expectations further were challenged through the times when, you see, Pip actually in part 3, and he meets Magwitch. Pip till this point had thought it was Miss Havisham who was the benefactor, the secret benefactor who was providing money for Pip to have his great expectations fulfilled. The arrival of Magwitch in the strange circumstances, if you remember, at midnight, his arrival, then his conversations with Pip revealed it to Pip that the actual benefactor was Magwitch and it was not Miss Havisham. So expectations related to Miss Havisham were also defeated. Now, finding Magwitch as his benefactor was yet another blow for Pip. He was not expecting a convict to be his benefactor, to be the person who was sponsoring or supporting him. This links with criminality and with criminals. This also once again threatened the very idea of great expectations that Pip had. Dear students, actually in Dickens' times, to be a gentleman meant to be a person who knows the manners of upper class, who behaves like the people of upper class, and who moves in the upper class. So in itself we can see that this idea of great expectations is superfluous and superficial. And Pip, though, learns how to dress up according to the needs or the trends of the modern society or the upper class society, and how to have the table manners according to that, and how to sit and mix up with people and socialize with them. Despite all this, we can see the superficial nature of all this, and actually there is no end as such that is to be met with this. There is another expectation of Pip that was defeated and that was challenged. Pip expected that when he would, as a gentleman, when he would become a gentleman and when he would go back to his own small place, his countryside place, there he would be treated as a great man and he would be given a lot of importance. That is why when you saw him going back to meet Miss Havisham and to meet Joe and Biddy, you also noticed that he was just walking through the streets and he was acting as a snob and he was behaving as if other people were far inferior to him. However, these expectations were again challenged when, despite the fact that there were some people who were being impressed and who were looking at him, we noticed that a small boy there makes fun of him and imitates him and copies him for his snobbish behavior. So this once again challenged his great expectations regarding his image that he wanted to have amongst his people as a gentleman. When it comes to great expectations and the defeat of these expectations on the part of Pip, there is another important aspect, that is with relation to Estella. Pip was always impressed by the beauty of Estella and he was inspired to win her. He wanted to win her attention and he wanted to marry her at some time point later. However, his expectations, or I would say great expectations with relation to Estella, they were quite of ironic nature, because towards the end of the novel what we came to know was that Estella's father was Magwitch and her mother was again a murderess. So what we come to know is of the very low origin of Estella. Estella, the word itself means a star, so Pip always looked up at her as an ideal, as a perfect incarnation of beauty and manners, and as a perfect representation of the upper class. This was the idealism related to the upper class and his desire to associate him with the upper class that made him associate himself with Estella. Now, ironically, Estella's origin is traced to be even lowly than Pip himself. She is far more closely related to Magwitch and a woman, both of whom, that is both of the parents, they are criminals. So in that sense, ironically, the title reflects that all these expectations, or the great expectations that Pip had with relation to Estella, they were all false. If you ask me, I would say that Pip's journey of what seemed to be a journey of great expectations at the beginning of the novel later on proved to be a journey of the realization of the false great expectations and of the realization that he could have small expectations, far more realistic and far more closer to the reality of life. So this was kind of giving a review on the title now that we have finished the novel. Before starting the novel, Great Expectations kind of foreshadowed as a title a different kind of a journey of the protagonist. Now that we have ended up, as I have already said, when we revisit what happened and how it happened, the title gains far more significance and it shows what actually Dickens meant by it. It is a satire on the upper class, it is ironic, it has symbolic meanings. Great expectations stand for all the aspirations, the fall aspirations of Pip. Great expectations of Pip also stand symbolically for all the false aspirations or desires of all the young people like him of his times and of other times, as Dickens has presented through the character of Pip. With this, we move on to another important aspect of the novel that I would like to discuss before we close this novel and move on to the next novel. And that is the role of the narrator in this novel. Well, the tradition of using a narrator in writing novels has always been there from the very beginning, and Dickens being one of the pioneers, actually, he played an important role in setting that tradition. However, a very, very interesting aspect of the role of the narrator in Great Expectations is that the narrator himself is Pip. Pip, now who has grown up, he is looking back at his past and he is narrating his whole story. So actually, when we go through the novel, we find a duality. We come across Pip, the narrator, who is telling the whole story, and we come across Pip, the child, who is actually going through this whole process. Through this, the writer, that is Charles Dickens, has been able to achieve a few objectives. The first one is to have an objective view. Now that the grown-up narrator looks back at all that happened, a more objective view can be presented through his voice. The second benefit of the use of this narrator is to have a more matured view. Whatsoever Pip felt at that time, and now the narrator Pip, who is looking back at that, looking back at all that, with a far maturer perspective and with a maturer eye, I would say, the narrator Pip is able to explain what happened to Pip, how he felt, what kind of expectations he had, and what happened to those expectations in a far, far better way, and a far mature way, of course. The role of narrator also helps the writer provide some additional information, something that cannot be incorporated in the happenings or the events that take place in the novel. That additional information comes to us through the mouth of the narrator, and thus he serves as a mouthpiece of Dickens as well, not only providing additional information about the events, happenings and characters in the novel itself, but also providing the philosophy or the viewpoint of Dickens as a writer by becoming a mouthpiece of the writer. The role of narrator that is assigned to the grown-up mature Pip, it also helps us have insights into child psychology. We can far better understand the psychology of young Pip as he goes through all these stages. Now, when the grown-up mature Pip as a narrator reflects back on what he felt and how he felt at what particular time. And now I would bring you to the end of the novel, giving final comments on that. Now that you have finished the whole novel, you have seen how Dickens as a reformer, how he as a satirist, and how he is a critic of what was happening in his society, has presented it through the story of a child, Pip. If you can recall when I started the novel, here with you in this course, I explained it to you that Dickens not only himself had all that experience of the financial pressures that children have to face and the child abuse in the society, but also you would see that relating these autobiographical elements into his novels with the wider experiences, he is a harsh critic of the injustice that is done to children. Again, the important satirical comments that we find with reference to law and with reference to the judgments that are given by lawyers and the people related to the field of law, we see how actually a lot of criticism is made on the existing systems. Overall, the novel is a sharp criticism on the English society with reference to generating false great expectations in its members by generating false great expectations in young people like Pip. And as a moralist, what we notice about Dickens is that his sole aim was to unwrap the real picture in front of people, to make his readers realize that these expectations, the so-called great expectations, are false. And through the process of learning of Pip, till the very end of the novel, he is a completely transformed man with his learning completed through these experiences. Actually, Dickens has tried to teach his readers, and I think that he is very, very much successful in doing that, because as the journey of Pip was taking place through the novel, and as the journey of his learning was taking place, so was the journey of the readers and their learning taking place through their reading. This is a list of the references that I have used for the work, and with this I bring you to the end of this novel. I hope you would have enjoyed doing this novel with me, and again, I would say visiting and revisiting the original text again and again would help you understand what Dickens had as his message, and the understanding of the relationships of characters, the relationship of themes, and the symbolic meanings of different symbols that he has used in the novel can be fully grasped only if you have access to the text and you try to explore the text in the light of what I have discussed with you throughout the novel. With this, I come to the end of our today's session. In the next session, inshallah ta'ala, we would start yet another novel. So till that time, Allah Hafiz.